Hello, maximum turning performance, in case we are considering horizontal steady coordinated turns, can be expressed in the time required to turn or the radius required to turn. As you can imagine, the bank angle plays an important role in this. The steeper an aircraft is banked at a specific airspeed, the smaller the turn radius and time to turn will be. In terms of maximum turning performance, it is therefore important first to solve the problem of the steepest turn. The steepness of a turn is defined by the bank angle and therefore also by the load factor. So how do you determine the maximum load factor that can be achieved? For this, the performance diagram can be used. It shows maximum thrust available and the aerodynamic drag in symmetric flight. However, in a turn, the pilot will have to increase the angle of attack and thereby the lift and drag coefficient. So the basic performance diagram is not valid for turning flight. Obviously, engine performance is not affected by the bank angle of the aircraft. The aerodynamic drag as a function of airspeed is affected on the other hand as well. Let's see how drag as a function of airspeed change in a turn. To do this, I will highlight one specific point in the drag curve. It is associated with a specific angle of attack and therefore to a specific lift coefficient and drag coefficient. Now, assume the angle of attack is kept constant. Lift coefficient and drag coefficient are fixed, and we determine what happens to airspeed and drag. Let me show you how that works. So, if we start with the load factor equation, load factor is by definition lift divided by weight. And lift can be expressed as CL times half rho V squared S. Now in the diagram we saw airspeed on the x-axis, so let's rewrite this equation and single out airspeed. If you do that, you get that airspeed is the square root of n times weight over s times 2 over rho times 1 over CL. And this is equal to the square root of n times the square root of weight over s times 2 over rho times 1 over CL. And remember that this term is the airspeed in horizontal symmetric flight. So this is what happens to the airspeed, and now let's have a look at the aerodynamic drag. Now drag is by definition CD times half rho V squared S, and V squared, of course, we know what the airspeed is, so it's CD times half rho times NW over S, 2 over rho, and 1 over CL. And these terms of air density nicely cancel out. We have a half here and a 2. And of course, I forgot to write down the S over here. So the S cancels out as well. And what we end up with is the following. So we see drag is CD over CL times the load factor times the weight. So in fact, CD and CL are only a function of the angle of attack. So we kept those constant. So essentially, if drag increases with load factor, then it's proportional to the load factor. Thus, the airspeed must increase proportional to the square root of the load factor to maintain the vertical force equilibrium in case angle of attack is kept constant. The drag, however, will increase proportional to the load factor for a fixed angle of attack. So this point over here is going to move upwards and to the right. And you could do that exercise for this complete graph. As a result, the whole drag curve shifts upwards and to the right. Two interesting things can be observed. The minimum airspeed, all the way over there, is increased, and the stall limit is encountered at a higher speed because part of the lift is used for turning and not to balance weight. And this must be solved by increasing lift by an increase in dynamic pressure. At the same time, it is not possible anymore to fly at certain airspeeds since the drag is more than the available thrust, as you see over here. So there are two factors limiting the turn performance: the aerodynamic limit and the propulsion system. In principle, my objective is to determine the maximum load factor at each airspeed. Let's say we calculated the performance diagram for various load factors, and you can see the different drag curves over here. Now let's go through the airspeed range, starting with the lowest airspeed in horizontal flight. The stall limit is encountered at a load factor of 1, hence the maximum achievable load factor is 1. At the slightly higher airspeed, the stall limit is encountered at n is 1.5 in this specific example. So the maximum achievable load factor is 1.5. If we go to an even higher airspeed, the thrust limit is encountered before the aerodynamic limit. In this case, the maximum achievable load factor is 2. Now we can go through this complete diagram to have all combinations of maximum load factor and maximum airspeed. You can see there is one airspeed which gives the highest load factor for the complete airspeed range. Typically, this occurs near the minimum drag condition, where the ratio of CL over CD is maximum. Concluding, the maximum achievable load factor as a function of airspeed can be determined quickly based on the performance diagram. It essentially depends on the aerodynamic characteristics of the aircraft, the propulsion system characteristics, and finally also two factors which we consider constant for the moment: the air density or altitude and the aircraft weight.